Do a search on Amazon for the word why, and this book will show up right at the start. Start with why, not start with how, not start with what, but start with why. And I want us to talk about why. Why we come to church, why we read our Bibles, why we study our Bibles, why we memorize Scripture, why do we do that? And I want us to look at 1 John chapter 1 with that question in mind. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, that we proclaim concerning the word of life. I was listening last week to this book, Cold Case Christianity by J. Warner Wallace, and it is a homicide detective's investigation of the claims of the gospel. You'll find it to be a very, very interesting book. If you enjoy reading apologetic books, I highly recommend this. If you enjoy apologetic books, you probably already run across this one. But he was a homicide detective, and he uses his skill to solve this cold case of the crucifixion and the resurrection, and uses those skills to examine the resurrection from the viewpoint of apologetics. And one of the key things he talks about is the importance of an eyewitness, the importance of an eyewitness. And that is what John is saying here. He's saying, I am an eyewitness to these things. I have seen them. I've handled them. I've tasted and touched these things. I have seen it. This is not just a philosophy. This is not just an idea I've made up. This is something I have seen. The life appeared, life. We have seen it and we testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life. You might ask your group, what is meant by eternal life when it appears in Scripture? Which was with the Father and has appeared to us. And the big idea I want to draw your attention to is that eternal life is more than living a long, 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 long time. Eternal life has to do with a quality of life, and that quality of life can start right now. It is the Spirit-filled life. It is the victorious Christian life. It is a life marked by the fruit of the Spirit, by love, by knowing that I'm loved and feeling love for you. It is marked by joy, starting most every day saying, what a time to be alive. It is a life marked by peace, the shalom, the good life. And this life can start right here in your life right now. That's the promise. That is the hope. That is the why of eternal life. It is not just living a long time. It is a quality of life and a quality of life that can start right now. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that, and that little word there, those two little words there, translate one Greek word, hina, that has to do with in order that. It has to do with answering the question, why. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that, for this reason. Why do we proclaim it to you? So that you also may have fellowship with others. And we're going to see this appears four times in this passage. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. I skipped over to the ESV here because the NIV didn't have the language so that, and I wanted to point out that language from the Greek. We are writing these things to you. Why? So that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from Him, and we declare to you, God is light. In Him there is no darkness at all. And I would encourage you to ask your people, what does the Bible mean when it speaks of light? This idea of the metaphor of light appears many, many times in Scripture, and we want to think about what does it mean that God is light. And essentially it means two things. It means light indicates truth, and secondly, light indicates holiness. If we claim to have fellowship with Him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. If we claim to have fellowship with Him and walk in the darkness. And the idea is our claim should match our walk. We should practice what we preach. How you live reveals what you really believe. How you live reveals what you really believe. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, His Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. In other words, if you imagine that you are not part of the problem, the truth is not in you. In contrast, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, not just merciful and kind, but He is faithful and just, and He will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make Him out to be a liar, and His word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that, the fourth so that in this passage, so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice. Some translations would have it. He is the propitiation. He is that which turns aside the wrath of God. If it were not for Christ, I would be the recipient of the just wrath of God. But Jesus was the propitiation for our sins, that he turned aside the wrath of God, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. So I'd ask you to read this passage again. Start by reading, asking your people to look for what we can we learn about why in this passage. And then when you finish, ask them the question again, what can we learn about why from this passage? And if you were to look at it in the Greek, you'd see this little Greek word hina is repeated four times in this passage. And four times he says to us, this is why I'm writing this letter. This is why I am communicating to you. And I think we could make the observation that this is why the whole Bible was written to us. And there are four reasons why. The first one is that we will all get along with one another. The second is that we will all get happy. The third one is that we will all live guilt-free lives. And the fourth one is that we will not sin at all. 1 John 1:3 says, we proclaim to you that what we have seen and heard, so that. Why? Why do we proclaim this to you? Why have we written this letter? Why was the Bible written to us? Why do we read the Bible every day? Why do we start the day with our Bible on our lap? Why do we memorize scripture? Why do we listen to sermons? So that you may also have fellowship with us, and our fellowship was with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. 1 John 1:7 says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sins. Romans 15:5 is a good cross-reference from the Message. It says, may our dependably, steady, and warmly personal God develop maturity in you so that you may get along with each other as well as Jesus gets along with us. In the desire of every parent's heart, if you're a parent, I'm guessing this was the desire of your heart perhaps when your children were young, you'd think about it that way, and that is that your children get along with each other. The desire of every parent is that their children be able to get along with each other. It brings me great joy to receive a text just a few moments ago that my new grandbaby was born this last weekend, and my daughter is driving over because she already loves that grandbaby, and what joy it gives me that my children get along with one another, and it is important to her that she come and celebrate this moment with her brother, my other son. And in the same way, the Heavenly Father looks down from heaven, and he deeply desires, his heart is that he deeply desires that we have fellowship with each other, and these things are written. This word is written that we may learn to have fellowship with one another, that we may learn to love one another. Now that's what matters to God. Does it matter to you? Does it matter to you? Does it matter to our world? Would this world be any better? Is there any need in this world that we would learn to get along with each other? Well, absolutely, positively, yes. There's a great need in this world that we would learn to love one another and that we would learn to get along with each other. And the Bible says these things are written. The Bible says the Bible's goal is, the Bible's purpose is, the purpose for memorizing scripture and reading scripture and starting your day with your Bible on your lap and listening to sermons and listening to YouTube videos. The purpose of it, the goal of it, is not just to make you a smarter sinner. The goal is that you would learn to get along with other people. I actually wrote a whole book on this a few years back. You can check it out on Amazon if you're interested, how to get along with almost anyone. And speaking of books, by the way, I wrote a new book and released it this last week. This is called One Page Bible Study Lessons. And there is a Bible study lesson for every chapter in the New Testament in this. And I encourage you to take a look at that on Amazon. And by the way, I'd ask you what every author would ask you. And that is, if you enjoy my lessons, that if you would write a positive review on Amazon, I would greatly appreciate it. But I would encourage you to ask your people the question, what do we learn about the why in this passage? And one of the things we learn is that these things are written so that you can get along, and then ask your group the question, what do we learn? What can you think of that the Bible teaches about how we can get along with one another? And I thought about a few things, but the truth is you probably think about a few more and discuss those together as a group. But here are some things that came to my mind. First thing the Bible teaches me about how to get along with one another is simply to always remember that I am heart of the problem, that I am a sinner. This passage emphasized that point, that I am a sinner trying to get along with sinners. And if I come into that relationship, if I come into every relationship realizing that I am, if I'm not very careful, if I'm not filled with the Spirit and obedient to God, I could very well be part of the problem. And there's a tendency to point our finger and blame and say, it's your fault and you're the problem and so on. And what the Bible teaches us is that I am a sinner trying to get along with a sinner, and I am almost certainly part of the problem. Second thing I learned is this idea of boundaries, the idea that we are not to lord it over other people, Jesus said. And that is, I am responsible for me, but I'm not responsible for you, and I'm not to control you. And if you try to control other people, if you try to lord it over other people, if you try to get other people, manipulate other people to do what you want, it will nearly always go badly. And the Bible teaches that we are autonomous, that we are created in the image of God, and that we have a dominion over our own life, but not dominion over your life. And if we recognize that, it's going to help us greatly in getting along with one another. Third thing we learn from the Bible about getting along with each other is simply the tone of our voice. Proverbs 15:1 says, a gentle answer. A gentle answer, not a right answer. And if you use a snitty tone, you're going to get a snitty return every single time. And the Bible says, what does the Bible say? These things are written so that you may have fellowship with one another, that you may get along with one another. And if you want to get along with one another, you would do well to realize you're part of the problem, to do well that we're all responsible for our own life. And thirdly, to do well to pay attention to the tone of your voice. Fourth thing that we would do is simply to try to find common ground. That's essentially what this word fellowship means. It means to have in common. And if you want to get along with other people, you want to seek those things which we have in common. You know, my dad was a master at this, and partly because he had a wide variety of life experiences, but you could set him down next to almost anybody on the planet and get him started talking in a little while. He would find something that he has in common with that person. He was born in Dallas, Texas, and was kind of a city boy, but you set him next to a country boy, a farmer perhaps, and he wouldn't talk about growing up in Dallas. He would talk about how he married a farmer's daughter, and he spent some time on the farm, and he spent some time on the tractor, and he could talk about farming like the best of them. And people who get along well with other people try to find what we have in common. Of course, then there's just the old idea of love, meaning we care for other people. We put them first. The Bible says, each of you look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. We are to try to sense their mood. We're trying to be empathetic. And that might sound like a lot of feel-good psychobabble to you, but the Bible says, rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. Now, how are you going to do that if you do not sense the mood of the other person? The people who get along well with the others always have their radar out and are trying to sense how that other person is feeling. And the last principle I would mention here comes off the top of my head is the principle of forgiveness. And the idea is that eventually forgiveness will become the most important issue in your life. And if you do not learn to forgive, the Bible says God will not forgive you. People are going to hurt you. And if we're going to get along with one another, we need to forgive one another. So these things are written that we would get along. Secondly, these things are written that we all get happy. 1 John 1:4, and we are writing these things to you so that. Why is the Bible written? So that our joy may be complete. Now, if you look this up in the King James, you'll find it says, not our joy, but your joy may be complete. If you'd like to sort out which one of these is, you might just look it up in a number of translations. Here's a graphic generated by Logos Bible Software, and you can see that the majority of the translations have our joy. That's all the ones underlined in orange there. And a few of them have your joy. That's the ones underlined in blue. And the King James, New King James, the Living actually covers both things. It says, then you too will be full of joy, so will we. And they cover both items there. But at the end of the day, it doesn't make that much difference. And you want to try to inspire your people with the confidence that they should have in the underlying manuscript evidence that we have in Scripture. There is no doctrine that stands or falls because of some discrepancy in textual evidence. And in this particular case, the truth is the Bible talks about both. It looks like he's saying we're writing this so that our joy will be complete. But it is also true that the Bible is written so that your joy will be complete. John 15:11 says, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. John 16:22, so with you, Now is your time of grief, but I will see you again and you will rejoice. No one will take away your joy. John 16:24, until now you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive and your joy will be complete. And just as I ask about how can we be happy, what does the Bible say, or how to get along, we want to ask also, what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about how we can live happier lives? And the first thing that comes to my mind, and by the way, I encourage you to spend a little time talking about that question as a group. People will remember what they say. And when they speak the truth, they are changed by the truth. But here are some things that come to my mind. I wish I was in a group with you and we could actually discuss this by way of video. This is the best we can do. But anyway, the first thing that comes to my mind is that I am going to take responsibility. I am going to take responsibility to be obedient to the command of our holy God to rejoice in the Lord always. I am going to take seriously my moral responsibility to try to live a happy life. C.S. Lewis famously said, it is a Christian's duty. It is the Christian's duty to be as happy as you can. And it is one of the most oft repeated commands in Scripture. Rejoice in the Lord always. It is my moral responsibility, and I'm going to work on it every day. Work on being as happy as I can be. Secondly, as much as possible, I want to try to get my life together. Zig Ziglar has this little riff where he'll comes to a gate agent at an airport, and he'll ask the gate agent, how are you doing today? And the gate agent will say, well, I'm doing okay under the circumstances. And Zig Ziglar would say, well, what are you doing under there? What are you doing underneath the circumstances? You need to live above the circumstances. And I want to tell you that works out real well until you've had your heart broken. And when you've had your heart broken, you're going to discover that the circumstances of life do impact your mood. And as much as it depends on you, you can't make everything go well in your life, but as much as it depends on you, you want to try to get your life together. You want to try to spend less than you make so that you have a little bit of savings and you have no debt. You want to try to get along with other people in your world. You want to try to take care of your health as best you can. And as much as it depends on us, we want to try to get our lives together. Thirdly, as mentioned a moment ago, we want to get along with the others. And then fourthly, and perhaps most important, we want to practice the activity of gratitude until it becomes a habit. I think there's something to be said for exercising and exercising outdoors. There's something about doing your God-given calling. And there may be some other things that the Scripture teaches us, but those are a few things that we can look at about what the Bible teaches us about how to get along with one another. All right, the fourth one is we want to live guilt-free lives. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just. And if we confess our sins in order that He will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Now, let me ask you a question about this. What problems does guilt cause? What problems comes to the life of a man who lives with a sense of guilt? Well, truth be told, all kinds of troubles come, and you might get your people to talk about that for a little bit. You might get them to Google it, and I've got a webpage you can look at and has some details on it from there. But the bottom line of that webpage is interesting, as I read about this. It mentions all kinds of trouble that comes from grief, but then it says these haunting words, there is no magical cure for excessive guilt. There is no magical cure for excessive guilt. And I want to say to you, we have a Bible. And that Bible was written so that you would come to understand that Jesus paid the penalty for your excessive guilt and truthfully for all your guilt. And these things are written so you could understand you can live a guilt-free life. And not only a guilt-free life where we're freed from the consequences of our past sins, but also a life where we are freed from the power of the current power of sin over us. We write these things so that you will not sin at all. Jerry Bridges famously said, a life-changing comment in his book, The Pursuit of Holiness, he talks about reading this passage one day and realizing that the passage does not say, we write these things so that you will not sin very much. But rather, he says, we write these things so that you will not sin at all, that you will not sin. And how do we do this? Well, I've given you this list of 21 things. I'm going to put it up on the screen again and say to you, I can teach you how not to sin at all. I can teach you how not to sin at all. I simply cannot do it in 15 minutes. And that is why we want to read the Bible daily. That's why we want to come back to church week after week after week. That's why we want to attend a Bible study week after week after week. So we come to understand the principle of faith. We come to understand the principle of trying. We come to understand the principle of training. We come to understand the importance of habit and so on. And as we understand all these things, the Bible's promise will come true for us. Not that we can ever completely stop sinning, but we can substantially stop sinning because of the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of the truth in our life. And may God richly bless you as you teach your people to live sin-free lives through the power of the Word and the power of the Holy Spirit in your life.